Good morning and welcome from all around the world to Structural Heart Live Cases, broadcasting from the Cardiac Catheterization Laboratory from Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. My name is Gilbert Tang. I'm a cardiac surgeon and the surgical director of the Structural Heart Program here at Mount Sinai, and welcome. We love to hear from you, so please send us your questions right from the website or via YouTube. Remember, you can also view all the previous structural heart cases at ccclivecases.org. We have a fantastic live case for you today, so without much further ado, let's go to the cath lab at Mount Sinai. Dr. Sharma, Dr. Kinney, and the rest of the team.
Okay, Gilbert, thank you very much. And I know you are, usually you are inside here with us, but you're a little changing role. You know, that's the life is all about, you change. And we are happy that you are moderating, and welcome all our viewers from the Mount Sinai Cath Lab for this structural case, knowing that the TAVR has become routine. But we always try to show something unusual, and this is what we show in this case with a very low left main height, that how you need to protect against occlusion, potential occlusion of the left main. With myself, Dr. Keeney on my right side, then we have Dr. Farjan Filsoofi, our surgeon. Further down, then we have our interventional or structural fellow, Amit Huda, and the Sahil Khera behind me. And of course, we have Dr. Stem Lerakis, our echocardiographer, and then we have Dr. Fried as anesthetist. So we are all ready with this patient, which will be done under conscious sedation. And we just want to start a little delay, but want to start our presentation. So let's show our slide and so basically, these are our involved faculty involved with their disclosures. And this is a 72-year-old patient who has worsening dyspnea for 3 to 4 months. Morbidly obese, has few risk factors and medications shown there. Labs are okay. EKG is first degree AV block, because it's important for patients who will have may develop heart block and require pacemaker outside. So it does have first degree AV block. QRS is narrow. And then, of course, patient has echo showing severe aortic stenosis, which we'll show you live, and non-obstructive CAD. Maybe I can ask our structural director here, interventional director Sahil Khera, on comment on EKG, that once we are looking at the EKG, what we are worried about as a pre-op, pre-TAVR screening.
So that's a very good question, Dr. Sharma, especially in low-risk patients, pacemaker post-TAVR is an issue. So you do want to look at how bad the PR conduction is, whether the patient has a pre-existing right bundle branch or a patient who has AFib with slow RVR. So we would look at if there's a pre-existing AV block, pre-existing right bundle, or AFib with slow ventricular response. Those patients would be at higher risk for post-procedure pacemaker.
So let's say with the SAPIEN traditionally has been a lower need for permanent pacemaker, and patient has a right bundle branch block. What number you give the patient that chances will require permanent pacemaker, and would you leave in that particular case temporary pacemaker for 24, 48 hours?
So we don't oversize more than 10% anymore at all in our balloon expandable cases, and I don't think anyone should with the ultra skirting. So I would still tell my patient anywhere from 3 to 5% is a risk of pacemaker if you have a pre-existing right bundle branch block.
And this become more important. Anu, you want to comment on that?
No, the question with the, what would be the, or which cases should need a neckline versus which case need a femoral line? I think for the SAPIEN, like Sahil mentioned, with this particular first degree AV block without right bundle, we'll still do groin. We will just watch the patient during the closure, which is usually 10-15 minutes. If there is no conduction defects or anything, we will remove the groin pacemaker and they'll just go to the regular floor.
Okay, very good. So let's keep going. Here the severe AS, and now we can show live. If we can go to the echo image, please. Patient has a high gradient of mean of 49. This is the echo.
Yes, good morning. On my left is Dr. Zhang, our structural imaging fellow. As you can see, this is a left parasternal view of the left ventricle, normal LV function. Very important in this case to evaluate for wall motion abnormalities, and there is none in this case. As you see, thickened and calcified aortic valve. This is a zoomed in image of the aortic valve. As you can see, very thickened, calcified, decreased motion of the leaflets. Minimal to mild aortic regurgitation. No evidence of pericardial effusion. Short axis, again, limited motion of the leaflets, thickened and calcified. four chamber view, normal LV function, no regional wall motion abnormalities, normal RV function, big atrium. As you can see, the peak velocity that we got this morning with the patient flat was 4.1. The previous echo on the left lateral position before the case, the velocity actually was 4.5. So today we've got a peak gradient of 66, mean gradient of 36, aortic valve area of 0.7 centimeters square, severe aortic stenosis. And this is a subcostal image, no evidence of pericardial effusion. Very important to know, and no regional wall motion abnormalities, supranormal ejection fraction of the left ventricle and the right ventricle. Thank you.
Beautiful. Okay, let's go back to our presentation now. So clearly established severe AS, mild AI. Think something?
Yeah, in the echo, I think Stam already mentioned, which is very important in this particular case, is since there is already the question about low left main, if at all there is occlusion, the first thing, of course, if you notice, a couple of things that we need to know is one, hypotension, and two, patient could go into ventricular arrhythmias. Any of these things happen, what a STAM will be doing is they'll be looking at the anterior wall motion to see if anything has happened. I mean, meanwhile, of course, we will be getting ready with other things. So that's the one point he already mentioned, how the anterior wall motion is normal.
Okay. Okay, let's keep going here. So this is our echo. We have already shown it. So we go to now Gilbert, or maybe actually now Sahil. Since usually Gilbert takes the comments on it, now it's your turn today on the CTA.
Sure. So a very benign annulus. There's not a lot of LVOT or annular calcium. Looks very favorable for a 23 advanced balloon expandable valve. If you can look at the STJ, there is some calcium on the STJ. The sinus of Valsalva are not very generous. On the left, it's 29 and change. So otherwise, a relatively safe balloon expandable case. We do want to look at the left main and the right coronary artery height.
So just from the sinus of Valsalva point of view, what is you call good from our interventional perspective, the good width of the sinus of Valsalva? How many millimeter?
So more than 30 millimeter, yeah. Dr. Sharma is.
So this is about 30, so yeah. It's a good sign for us. And this is where the potential trouble. Tell us a little more on this.
Right, so you can see on the left picture that the left main height is 5.4 millimeters. Ideally, you would want it more than 10 millimeters to have a safe a clearance. So 5.4, more concerning here is that you have a longer left leaflet. Although luckily it's not very calcified, not very bulky. That's why we are thinking about protecting it just because of the low left main.
Okay, and RC is okay?
RC is clean, yeah.
Okay, what about the groin axis?
The groin axis is relatively benign. We don't see a lot of calcium. There's a high bifurcation on the right side. So we use the left side for the main axis.
Okay, and therefore we sum it up. 72-year-old female with the symptomatic severe aortic stenosis with a low STS risk mortality, and decision made with a transfemoral TAVR using 23-millimeter SAPIEN-3 Ultra Valve with left main protection via left percutaneous femoral artery, as you said, with sentinel cerebral embolic protection device. So I think before we go on to the true case, maybe we can ask now Dr. Phil Sufi, our surgeon, that usual our guidelines are more than 65 patient aortic stenosis, irrespective of the STS risk, TAVR is preferred. But some cases, still more than 65, we are sending for surgery. What are those usual cases are?
Most these patients that currently we see with aortic stenosis have also concomitant coronary artery disease. So in most of these patients who are low risk, we see a combination of coronary artery bypass grafting and aortic valve replacement. There are also additional patients who may have a significant annular calcification, who may have a risk of annular rupture with TAVR. They're sent for surgical aortic valve replacement, as well as patients who have a bicuspid valve or associated ascending aortic dilatation that may require ascending aortic replacement. It's more a combination of combined surgery as well as high-risk TAVR, such as annular rupture or a high leaflet that may cause coronary obstruction.
Beautiful. So there basically is that once you are 70 plus kind, everybody agrees should go for TAVR unless proven otherwise or some other complication. Maybe Gilbert, you want to add anything else which we left, that which patient more than 70 years of age, which is otherwise fine, low STS, low to intermediate STS risk score, you will send for, you'll selectively say it's a hostile anatomy for TAVR and should go for surgery.
Yeah, I think Farsan brought a very good point. I think the other set of patients we commonly see are multivalvular patients, right? So they have, let's say, AS and a primary MR, which we know primary MR is unlikely to improve after TAVR. So if they're appropriate, I think they should be considered for double valve surgery as well. I think because then you can cure them of the disease.
What about some outlet LVOT calcium? Or a left ventricular hypertrophy. As you see, we are on the floor also. Anu has just crossed the valve and we are getting ready for that. What about the calcium position? Heavy calcium in some area of the aortic, in the side of the aortic valve or outlet, that will deter one versus other, knowing that could have higher chance for aortic rupture?
Yeah, it's not just rupture, right? I think there's now some evidence showing that if the valve is underexpanded or have residual PVL, that might have implication on these lower risk and younger patients. So I think we need to carefully evaluate those as well. Because any rupture, if you do it properly, it's pretty chance is pretty low. But I think PVL and maybe underexpansion affecting durability would be a concern.
Okay. Can we show the hemodynamics also in the bottom, please? Split the screen on the left side. The valve has been crossed and the gradient, which was said, mean gradient about 40 plus, confirmed. I don't know.
Yes.
Let's go.
So let's go. So now, just wanted to say that Sentinel, there's a radial loop, so we could not place the Sentinel. So right groin, we have the guide. We always like, this is a long left main, so we do have a VL guide. And we just cross the valve. The left side is the main axis.
Show it on the floor.
Yep. If they can see, left side is the main axis, if they can see here.
Good.
Since we are going to do the BAV, so what we'll do is we'll do the...
This one we can...
Direct, right?
Yeah, I think we should go direct.
Direct, we can go with the direct, right? Not that much calcium. I know a lot of data. Should you pre-dilate versus what? Clearly, pre-dilatation has its own disadvantages, particularly some acute complication of AI, but more importantly, slightly higher CVA rate. So in this particular case, if you would have done the BAV, then we will not engage the left main yet. Do the BAV, then you engage, then put a wire and do a left main protection. But in this particular case, the decision is made that calcium is there, but not a heavy calcium. So just go with the valve directly. Gilbert, any comment on that? One versus other should... why we should be doing just a direct valve without pre-dilatation?
Yeah, I think it depends on the situation. Certainly in bicuspid calcified cases, we've been more aggressively pre-dilate. Again, I think from the point of view of frame expansion, with left main protection, I think if there's not much calcium, certainly I think it's appropriate to consider just go directly to valve. But I think we need to make sure we can cross the valve pretty easily, because if not, then we might have to make the procedure more complex. So we've been more towards conserved and actually pre-BAV these cases, but certainly we can go case by case basis.
The valve choice, so whether self-expanding versus balloon expandable, chances for pre-BAV. One versus other, which will be a little more selectively in the self-expanding versus balloon expandable?
Yeah, my personal preference, and I think we can speak on our group as well, is that pre-BAV, I know there's some concept about acute decompensation. Well, no, we've even pre-BAV in moderate AI, as long as the valve is ready, we can go up quickly. I think we just don't like to post-dilate, because you have to make sure there's the risk of valve migration, risk of rapid pacing again to post-dilate, especially in self-expanding valves. So I think we've been more aggressive with pre-dilatation in general. But with self-expanding valve, you really have to look at the calcification. If there's severe calcification, pre-dilatation would be helpful to help with the frame expansion.
Okay. Very good. So Anu, now the next step is you put a wire and stent in the left LED left main?
Yeah. So the question comes, which are the cases we think we should just leave a wire? Which are the cases that we should place a stent? In this particular case, the sinus is just upper limit of normal. Then the left main is very short. I mean, normal acceptable is about 11. We are about 5 point something. So, low left main how to engage. And then other one is also the leaflet. Leaflet is also tall. So taking everything, three things into consideration, we are going to place a stent. So left main is 4-0. We will take a 4-0-16 stent and park it in the LAD. I'm just going to engage the left main now, and then we will wire into the LAD.
What is the logic right of using such a long stent compared to its very short left main and so?
I think there are two things. One, left main is long. And then you may want to bring part of the left main, like a chimney, into the sinus.
So basically, bring the significant part of the stent into the aorta, abutting the
into the sinus,
the TAVR
valve. Yeah. Some guy.
So this is a VL six French VL 3.5.
Okay, good. Now we went in. Yeah. Good.
Any role of stent choice in these cases? Would you use a stent with more radial strength?
I think the more radial strength, so that don't go with a very ultra thin struts, stents with the synergy or zero. I think, in my opinion, Promus or Zions will be good enough. It's about
Probably 75-80 micron compared
to 60.
Mega.
Yeah. And although now we have another
Megatron.
Stent,
I mean, Megatron. This
Megatron
is a case.
Stents, yeah.
But we only have 4-5.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. That's good.
Okay. Okay, so,
so another key point when we are going up and everything, that the wire in the coronary has, we have to pay attention, one person holding the guide and the wire. So the guide movement, that we do not cause injury to the left main with the guide or the wire going too distally and causing a wire perforation. So it's equally important. So we will now go up with the 4016 stent and leave it in the distal left main to prox LAD. And we connect with the indiflator. Do we have epi in the room? Epi?
Yeah,
crashes.
We have the epi, yeah.
Good. And not open, close, and this way.
Yeah, I think you can also see in this case that we did not have a pigtail in the root. And the reason being is that we, you'll see shortly, then we pull the guy back to use that as an injection, because in small roots like in this case, there's too much hardware and can be making manipulation difficult.
Yeah. Okay, good. So bring the valve.
Has been stent expand? The stent has been expanded.
Yes. No, we have placed it. Good.
Okay.
Over there. Leave it there.
The a little further.
Yeah, a little further there, because guide has to be displaced from the ostium anyway.
Yeah.
Once you've got this, we'll leave it. Same.
Yeah.
So again, guide injection will be good enough for positioning the TAVR valve. And what size we are using here?
23. Nominal.
Okay.
So we are checking orientation. Dr. Philosophy, you want to check the orientation?
The skirt is ventricular here.
Sure.
Okay. Good.
Let's go to the implant angle now as well, so we don't have to do too much manipulation.
Go to the implant angle, And ACT, what is the ACT?
312.
312. So always be keeping it about 300.
Okay. I'm advancing.
Yeah.
Slow.
You need dry gauze, you are okay. So it's always a tight fit through the sheath. So just go small bites.
23 push. Is okay.
Yeah, it's 26.
Good. Yeah. That's good. Nice. Okay. Good. So we're going to do the three movements.
Take this out? Or
not yet, at the end.
Okay. Good.
You want to go a little at the straight part?
A little bit, yeah.
Okay, good.
Now loading the
back. We are loading the balloon into the valve. The small, bring it towards you. Okay, no parallax. Looks good. Stop there. Yeah, good. Undo. And now he's going to advance. Going across. So I'm going to make sure I'm holding with the other one hand, left hand, I'm advancing the TAVR valve. Okay, you want to hold the guide?
Yep.
Hold the guide and the stent. Okay, so there could be some tight there. Okay, we are across.
Yeah.
Okay. So we are undoing it. Unsheath.
Yeah.
Right.
And can we make it for the audience?
No. Yes. Okay.
Magnified.
Magnified. Yeah.
So they can show the audience a bit more on the left main anatomy position, and they can center the screen. Very nice.
Yep.
Looks pretty good there.
Mm. Okay, go. You're holding everything. Yep, yep, yep. Guide. Go. No. So this is for you to. Okay. So I'm holding. Yeah. Don't do anything. Now are we in the position?
Implant view.
Implant view.
One second.
Somebody hold the wire.
Good. Something.
That's good. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Go.
Good. So I have Amit Huda holding the wire. Sahil is going to inflate. I am holding the TAVR valve, and Dr. Sharma has the guide. If you see his hand, he has the guide as well as the stent and the wire.
One extra person
just to play, focus on the stent and the wire. I think this is a very important point. See, the guide is outside, so we are using the guide instead of a pigtail to understand the position of the valve. And at the same time, it is outside when we are inflating, so it does not get sucked into the left main. That way, there will be any kind of injury. If you see there, this is exactly, I'm going to go Sine. This is how it looks. Yeah. Okay, ready for the picture, right? 180. Inject. Okay, stop.
Stop.
Good. Stop.
I think we can go in a little bit. Gilbert?
Yeah, I agree.
Yes, I would go in.
Okay.
A little bit.
Just a hair. Yeah.
It's, yeah, yeah, it's I went a little bit.
It's fine.
Yeah. I think that's good now.
Yeah, yeah, this is good. Very good.
Okay, 180 again. This is just a test. Inject.
It didn't move.
Okay, good.
Off.
Yeah, I went in a little bit.
No, it didn't move, right? I think we need to go 1 millimeter more. But I don't think you need to test it again.
Yeah.
But just...
Yeah,
that's just good. Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Okay.
Okay, everybody ready? So we'll be going up now. 180.
Going up.
Go.
Very nice.
Go full.
Yeah.
Continue. Okay. Deflate. I'm just going to add, come out.
Off pacer. Resuscitate.
Yeah. So in this particular case, we got a left main. Some cases we do have our epi ready on our table. While our anesthetist colleagues are very aggressive in managing these cases, we also have that you can give intra aortic or maybe even sometime intraventricular epinephrine.
Okay.
Yeah. But didn't need anything.
Take a picture.
Pressure is back here.
Beautiful.
Yeah, it's nice. So you see the white line sign?
So that is the leaflet?
Yeah, that's the leaflet. That is, the flow in the left main is very good. And we'll go a couple of other views. Usually what we do is one cranial. We'll decide it will be straight AP cranial or LAO cranial. And a couple of views we need to do. Blood pressure is good.
Can we take the ventricular wire out? I mean, we don't need that wire now.
Yeah.
Sure.
You can take the ventricular wire out. Okay.
Good. Now, issue is here to see whether need to bring that, take the stent out and throw it or put it in the left main.
So this is a good view.
Magnify more, no?
No. Yeah. Okay. Ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Inject. No, there's enough space. I don't think we need to stent it. Gilbert, you agree?
Yeah, no, this is very good. So you can see that the white line, especially given it's not very bulky, that, it's actually fine. But if it's bulkier, then you would be more concerned. So the CT can be helpful with that.
Beautiful.
Yes.
Good.
I think the key thing was, though the leaflet was long, but it was not bulky, no calcium at the tip of the leaflet. So these were all favoring us. So if everybody agrees here, I'm just going to take the stand. Or you want to do a quick, Dr. Stam wants to do
a
quick.
Point.
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. To make sure that anterior wall remains hypercontractile. More blood flow now.
Based on the hemos, we should not have any
issue. Keep showing the hemodynamics in the lower screen on the left side, please.
Yeah, normal function, no, actually, good. Hyperdynamic, small ventricle. Anterior wall is normal. The valve looks great.
It looks like it needs some volume.
Yeah, volume, yes.
Yeah. No, we need some extra volume.
No AI. As you can see,
beautiful.
No pericardial effusion.
Beautiful.
Hyperdynamic anterior wall.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
So I'm just going to take out the stent. So we have to be very cautious here if we can show how we are going to remove it. There's a risk of a stent being stripped, metal to metal contact with the TAVR valve. Let's see. Yeah. So if you hold it. Oh, it's not coming easy.
And if there is ever question, you can always go with the guideliner, put into the vessel, and then bring the stent back into the guideliner. If you see that the stent may be stuck there because the tip of the guide catheter.
It may
don't get
off.
A guideliner?
You have to cut the stent then, no?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
See that? Yeah.
It's a little push pull.
Yeah.
So but the push pull has to be very cautious because this the strengths are very notorious to be stripped. And if you think that sometimes it does happen, you see some stripping, then don't pull anymore. Just deploy the stent at that level. So I'm going to take out the wire.
We can do a dancing aortogram now.
Yes.
No, it's a very important point that Dr. Kinney brought up because the top of the S3 valve, the frame against the STJ, to be very careful about interaction with the stent when you're on your way to retrieval. That actually might be harder than deploying the valve. So I think that's yeah. important. Let's take the parallax out, maybe, and Megan. Or
it's a nice, okay. We call it a dancing aortogram.
Beautiful. Yeah, looks very good.
Okay.
The good
this
from
can come out.
Hemodynamics, you know, echo looks great. From aortogram looks so no AI.
And even you see that our EKG looks fine.
Diastolic
so we'll
pressure.
Be monitoring another 10 minutes when there's a closure, and if everything looks good, our femoral vein temporary wire will come out.
And the diastolic pressure is good.
You wanted more?
So no. Dr. Kinney, you want to talk about if we are using a self-expanding platform, left main protection. What are the steps if you're doing left main protection? Would you use a guideliner up front in those cases?
Yeah. If it's since the cage is taller, right? If you are doing a self-expanding, in that situation, you definitely need guide extension so that you have the guide extension that is, extending all the way to the left main. And you will have a stent there. There, you may also need a longer stent. Since you want to, the stent has to come from left main and then into the aorta, from sinus up to the aorta. So we would have probably, in this particular case, we would have probably taken a 20 or a 24 stent, 4-0.
Yeah, nothing. No AI at all.
No AI. And look at the diastolic pressure. We always actually have, as a part of the timeout, we say that what is the diastolic pressure? Because that gives you a little gaze about any AI. And this patient's diastolic pressure before we started was 70 and now it's 85.
Peak gradient of 10.
10. So it basically just showing that there's no aortic regurgitation. So from interventional point of view, while Sahil and Amit, they're going to close the groin, from procedure point of view, we are done. And we actually ask, maybe make a comment to Dr. Phil Sufi because he has patient ready. After this case, he'll go down and we'll thank him to be present for as a part of the heart team.
No, I enjoyed the case. It was a difficult case. I think when the left main implantation is low, there is always a risk of coronary obstruction, even with surgery. And the way you handled it by protecting the left main was very elegant with an excellent result.
Okay, beautiful. All right, let's go to our presentation of today. We always have we can go back to the slides. So basically what we're going to talk about is the structural heart interventional trials from TCT 2021. Partner 3, we have two-year data, SIRT-AVI 5-year outcome, and TransCent 6 months outcome. So basically, this was published earlier this year, 2-year clinical outcome, of the low risk partner 3 trial. Remember low STS risk score, 1 year benefit, and now we have the 2 year data in 94% of cases, 96% of cases showing continued benefit superiority of the TAVR in the death, stroke, or rehospitalization, although death or disabling stroke were identical. Now you do see little catch up. At 1 year, there was little separation of death or disabling stroke in favor of TAVR, but at 2 years, both kind of very superimposed. The difference of 2.1% became only 0.8%. And then as far as the quality, the measures, they all significant improvement in both the categories, whether it's a TAVR surgery versus TAVR and so. So clearly it's a, overall, the significant improvement. And now we also learn that the benefit which occurs is not only at 1 year, but continued. So slightly little less, I would say, the separation, but continued. But this is where we need to worry about what will happen subsequently, 5 year follow-up and 10 year catching up, but will be identical. So that's what we expect. Only one issue remain while TAVR is plus, plus, plus in every aspect is the valve thrombosis. Look at the 1% versus 0.2% versus surgery at of 2.6% versus 0.7% at 2 years become significant. So valve thrombosis is a big issue, and those are higher gradients and so on and so forth. So what was presented also in the TCT was the economic outcomes of a TAVR versus a SAVR for low risk patient. Clearly, we know it's effective strategy. Question is it cost effective compared to surgery in low-risk patients? So these are the two-year data which was presented by David Cohen and basically showed that in hospital, so basically we know the TAVR valve cost. Remember the TAVR valve cost is higher. Therefore, the procedural cost was higher. And if you take all of them together in hospital, was clearly the TAVR was a little more expensive compared to surgery, but non-significant. $591, little more compared to surgery in hospitalization cost. Now, let's go outside. From discharge to 30 days, 30 days to 6 months, 6 months to 12 months, clearly you see that TAVR remain less expensive at each point, except that at 12 to 24 months was slightly higher, maybe part of that re-intervention which came up in the show. So overall, at 2 year follow-up, it was 19,638 cost of the TAVR, and surgery was 22,258. Means TAVR had 2620 lower cost, p value was just 0.1. But just to say, the TAVR on 2 years was not expensive, rather cheaper than surgery. So this was a very good message which we got here, that you take a total 2 year cost in favor of the TAVR. Now, how does he put it? So we really want decrease cost and increase quality of life. If you can have this, that's where the TAVR comes in. Clearly, the dominant strategy, and that is where, as we know, the whole field has evolved using the TAVR. Despite a slightly higher cost initially, that overall cost is cheaper. And so now various component, the subgroup analysis in terms of the financial. So everywhere the TAVR remain the dominant strategy in terms of financial, economical impact positively for TAVR. So basically was that at 2 year, it was cost saving compared to surgery, and it's projected to be highly cost effective over a lifetime horizon, as long as there's no difference in the late mortality between two strategy, because quality of life incorporate patient survival. So as long as we remain same, and so far we have been fine, actually numerically slightly lower mortality at 2 year compared to surgery, but we expect that the long-term data will tell us those. Second was the SIR-TAVI trial, which was the trial of using a self-expanding valve of Medtronic, 5 year data which were presented in this was actually earlier core valve, and Evolute was about 16%. And the 5 year data basically showed in terms of various outcomes. These are the comparative groups, which are all comparable, original trial. So let's see what happened in the at 5 years of the all-cause mortality or disabling stroke. Exactly identical outcome, very reassuring. In intermediate, 5 years, exactly identical outcome of the TAVR versus surgery. And of course, you take it from a landmark analysis 2 years, from 2 years to 5 years, exactly identical, no difference, no catch-up, all-cause mortality. Again, exactly identical, disabling stroke, numerically remain higher with surgery compared to TAVR, but never made a p-value difference. Remember, the disabling stroke at 2 years, at the original point, the residual deficit disabled stroke, not overall CVA, was significantly lower. The disabling stroke was significantly lower with the TAVR versus surgery, but overall still remain in positive in terms of the TAVR, but p-value became negative. Now, overall, as you can see here, the same issue of the valve thrombosis that we need to worry about. There's always, in this particular group, valve thrombosis, as you see, at 2 years was trouble. 0.4 versus zero. And of course, rest of the points are shown very clearly. So this is what we worry about. Valve intervention, 2 year, 2.5 versus 0.5, but after 2 year was identical. So key is that if anybody degenerate, and we know that, those are the cases where all issue have been of the valve thrombosis and leaflet immobility and so forth, rehospitalization and all, again, significant, non-significant. What remains significant is here, the core lab assessment of the hemodynamics. Look at the TAVR valve area and the gradient compared to surgery. At 5 years, the surgical valve was 1.8 and it was 2.2 of the TAVR valve. So whether it will translate into a better outcome need to be seen. But these all endpoints in terms of the valve area, aortic valve area was higher with the TAVR valve versus surgical valve. And of course, the leaky, definitely there is a leak. There's no leak in the surgical cases. We do have a paravalvular leak with the patients and same Kansas City cardiomyopathy questionnaire, all were identical. And so also improvement with the New York Heart Association class. So overall, I would say the CERTAV 5-year summary is very positive, but only thing is we still need to worry about valve thrombosis in first 2 years, although endocarditis was no difference, and the paravalvular leak. And clearly, that is what we do now. So remember, in 84% in this case, in this trial, was the original core valve. Then evolute R with that, clearly the paravalvular leak decreased subsequently. Then lastly, which was very interesting, the tricuspid valve, which we say the forgotten valve, while a lot work being done with the mitral, aortic, I would say that already done, mitral going on, and now the tricuspid valve and the data, clearly the tricuspid remains the issue, and from the surgical point of view, surgeons don't want to deal with the tricuspid because of very high, these patients have a lot of comorbid conditions and so, and we know that degree of tricuspid regurgitation is associated with the higher mortality of 85 plus percent at 10 years. So maybe before I go on to the show the data of this, we can ask, since Dr. Phil Sufi is still here, about the tricuspid surgery. Tell us about what is your feeling compared to any other surgery in your cardiothoracic arena versus the tricuspid surgery.
So the trend for the last 10 years has been, most of it because of the work that has been done here and by Dreyfus, patients who undergo mitral or aortic valve surgery, if they have even mild to moderate tricuspid regurgitation, we have a low tendency to repair these valves in order to prevent down the road tricuspid regurgitation. Also, if they have actually minimal tricuspid regurgitation with significant annular dilatations, we have a tendency to treat them and so forth. The problem comes the patients who have not been addressed and they develop late tricuspid valve regurgitation. And we know that the reoperative tricuspid valve regurgitation carries a very high operative mortality, which actually has been consistent over the last two decades, somewhere between 10 to 15%.
And that's a very interesting because even in the our TVT registry data of the mitral clip, the degree of tricuspid regurgitation correlated with the outcome from anywhere from 15% mortality at 1 year versus 50% if you're TR. So TR on top of so any, whether mitral valve or whether surgical or tricuspid, the mitral, our TR with the mitral clip is correlated with the subsequent prognosis. So now this new device, Evolute Tricuspid, Evoke Tricuspid Valve Replacement System. It is a full valve replacement. So it is not a parted, it's full, anchors compatible with pre-existing leads, respect to the native anatomy. And of course, it's a 44, 48, and 52 millimeter, goes through 28 French trans-femoral delivery system. As you can see, nice prong, takes the leaflet in the to anchor the secure placement, and then you deploy it. And you see here that valve start functioning, and the evoke the data presented for total 132 patients, which have been done with a 6-month follow-up, 56 patient, high-risk patient, as shown here, and the overall great success. Percutaneously done, all of them with device success of 96% with implantation time shown here, then hospital disposition, length of stay about 3 days, and more important, you worry about the complications, and these are the complications. Very reasonable, having a 2.4% the 30-day mortality, 81% patient had a no major adverse event, and pacemaker need was 10.5%. Gilbert, you are the tricuspid master. What is your feeling about this very exciting data of the tricentral?
Yeah, no, I think we know that with replacement, you eliminate the TR, and these patients who have really tethered leaflets, they're really not amenable to any kind of edge-to-edge or repair therapy would benefit, and you can see that here in the data. I think the two main points that you brought up is the severe bleeding, you know, of 17-18%, you know, it needs to resolve that, and that might be just due to the patient comorbidities that they are, you know, have liver dysfunction and other facts. But also, I think one of the emerging points about this therapy is pacemaker. You see that 10.5% pacemaker they evoke, and that's actually on the lower side. I think some other devices may have a higher pacemaker, and that's because of the oversizing you need to anchor these valves, and the conduction system, as you know, is right there near the tricuspid annulus. So, you know, we need to, I think, do a better job with these patients because it's hard to manage them with a pacemaker. You know, now they have a valve replacement in there. What do you do? Are you going to put in a leadless pacemaker? How are you going to manage that? And even some patients have previous pacemaker leads. How do you manage those? So I think, you know, we learn a lot, and this is very promising. So let's see what the one-year data show next year.
Now, let me ask you another important point, knowing on the left side with the tear, with the mitral clip, knowing that the dominant strategy for mitral regurgitation and any of the new TMVR devices are being compared against the mitral clip or, you know, tear, transcatheter edge-to-edge repair. So will you think will be the same situation on the tricuspid side also? I know you are the PI of the tri-clip, and you are very actively enrolling the patient, huh?
Triluminate.
Yeah, triluminate.
Yeah, no, I mean, we've tackled some of these patients, and what we found is that if the gaps are small and the leaflets are mobile, I think TEER is a very good and option. In fact, we just did an off-label case because the patient was on dialysis, and the imaging was very suboptimal, and with 4D ice assay, it was less than an hour, and we got the TR from severe to mild. So that's a very feasible case for TEER. But, you know, I think these patients in the TRISEN are the ones that will be rejected by these trials. So I think they will be complementary. I don't think they will be necessarily competitive. And also, you don't want these patients to be on the general anesthesia TE for a long time just to try to grab the leaflets. If you can replace the valve, and this study showed the procedure time is very short, I think it's very beneficial to the patient because you don't have to worry about residual TR.
Yeah, I know, but knowing that you have been involved in those triluminate cases and you have some good device which is done in 74 minutes from start to finish, what is your comment on the very preliminary data? But you know, 100 plus cases, I mean, I won't call it preliminary. I mean, 100 plus cases done with no with the procedural no mortality, cardiovascular mortality of 2.5% at 30 days. I mean, it's a very remarkable.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think all that has been discussed here. It's patient-based, depending on what the presentation and what the cause for the TR is. But of course, if there is a procedure, there's a learning curve, and this looks like probably it will be a complementary, treatment for patients with TR, and maybe this may be the way to go rather than, since imaging is a key, you know, in a tricuspid clip, the imaging is a key, and most often we say we are not able to do the procedure because there is no imaging modality, because these older people also have a comorbidity that now we cannot get a TE in them because of some esophageal problems. So this device is something that probably will change, will be a game-changing treatment for these patients who have otherwise no other option.
Great. So now very interesting is this. Look at the significant reduction in TR by core lab. Look at the left side. they have the trace, mild, moderate, severe, massive, and torrential. All disappeared. Nobody is more than none or mild at 6 months. I mean, that's a very, very effective treatment strategy. So valve really works very nicely. I mean, this is a very plus point that almost everybody, and of course, those were low complications at follow-up, including the quality of life outcomes, all good. So clearly, we have the device now, and they're starting the pivotal randomized trial. TRISCEND II is underway. The question will be, pivotal randomized trial will be what? Against medical therapy, optimized guideline GDMT, or any other device, right, Gilbert?
Yeah, I believe TRISCEND II is against medical therapy because remember, yeah, there are no edge-to-edge device that's approved right now commercially, right? So they cannot randomize to another investigational device. But I can tell you that medical therapy, these patients will be doing very poorly. We know that from the surgical literature. We know that from the cardiology literature. So I have no doubt that replacement will be the winner here, I think, you know, once the results are available.
Okay. So just to sum up very quickly, our 3 points, 2 year follow-up partner, three trial, showed better clinical and echocardiographic outcomes after TAVR versus SAVR. Also at 2 year, TAVR was more cost effective versus surgery. And the new tricuspid valve replacement has shown good promise in initial trials in terms of safety and efficacy. And of course, 5 year follow-up SIR-TAVI trial, also very good with higher valve area at 5 year, but clearly we need to worry about the valve intervention. Quickly, let's complete our today's presentation with the three questions. The following are findings of partner 3 trial, 2 year outcomes, except TAVR remains superior to SAVR in primary endpoints. TAVR remains equal to SAVR in death and stroke. TAVR is more cost effective versus surgery. And TAVR has similar valve thrombosis versus surgery. As we know, that there is higher valve thrombosis compared to surgery. Second, 5 year data of SIR-TAVI trial showed the following, except similar death and stroke between TAVR and SAVR, similar quality of life improvement between TAVR and SAVR, similar aortic valve area between TAVR and SAVR, and higher valve reintervention at 2 years after TAVR versus SAVR. Clearly was the higher aortic valve area with TAVR versus SAVR at 5 years. Then the outcomes of the TRISCEND trials of EVOKE tricuspid valve replacement is true. Significant TR reduction with residual less than mild TR in 100% of patients. Significant TR reduction with residual mild TR in 50% of patients. Significant TR reduction, residual mild TR in 80% of cases. And significant TR reduction with residual moderate TR in 20% of cases. And answer is A, that is true, that TR almost goes except for the mild in very rare patients. With that note, we complete our today's presentation and we take it back to you, Gilbert, for conclusion.
Great. Well, thanks very much, Dr. Sharma, Dr. Kinney, and the rest of the heart team. And thank you for joining us today at the exciting case, structural heart case, last one of the year, I would say. The recording of this case will be archived at CCC Live Cases later today. The structural heart live cases occur every other month on a Tuesday at 9 a.m. So the next one actually will be in the new year, 2022, January 11th at 9 a.m. So hope to see you again. Take care and have a good rest of the day.
And then we are the New York Valve. New York Valve,
that's
December
right.
9th.
December 9th. So please get your registration ready and stay tuned, and we'll have an exciting program for you.
And it will be hybrid. A lot of in-person as well as the on the web, but hybrid, but clearly want to do an in-person meeting, and we have put everything together. An agenda has been circulated. We'll be updating everyone. Please come. We are inviting everyone for our December 9th. This is a new place, ETC venue. You have all the information. So we sincerely requesting people to attend, and particularly show that COVID is gone or almost gone. Thank you.
Thank you.